Hi there everybody, welcome to Organisational Behaviour Buzzy 1029. In this video we're going to talk about group structure. The video builds on our previous lecture recording looking at group formation. And now we want to think about how can we describe and understand groups once they are formed. So we're going to look at three different perspectives. We're going to start off looking at some network perspectives on group structure. So some attempts to understand groups as networks. We're then going to think about the importance of leadership and the role of different styles of leadership in determining the type of groups that form. And then we're going to think about the different types of roles that develop typically in groups. So, early studies of groups tended to look for some common trends or elements in group structure. Sharif, for example, in 1953, studied groups of children at summer camps and, you know, kind of adventure holidays. And what he found was that when groups of kids were put together in pretty random groupings, they tended to form very similar structures. They tended to develop hierarchies, so they would have leaders and followers. They tended to have very clear role relationships and common norms of behaviour, many of the features that we would associate with organisations. So Sharif developed this notion of intergroup relations, the idea that once you form a group, inside that group you tend to have a hierarchy, you tend to have set roles with specific norms governing behaviour, the types of language that gets used, the types of jokes that one is meant to find funny, the types of aims and values that are expressed. Sharif's work then sets something of a good, gives us something of a good illustration of what we might call network perspectives on groups. And this is an attempt to describe groups themselves. Another good example would be the work of William White. In Street Corner Society, White observed groups of people in US cities. And his key finding was, whilst you were to just look at street corners, you know, people hanging out around shops and on storefronts, you would think that they weren't organised at all. You would just see people walking around. You would see a lot of mess. But White took the time to stop and watch them and interview them. And what he started to notice was, amongst all that hustle and bustle, that seeming mess, there was actually some clear group structure. There were specific groups of people who hung around together, interacted in set ways, and White started to document this in his book Street Corner Society. So like Sharif, White's argument was that when groups form, they tend to develop specific structures around hierarchy, specific roles of leaders and followers, specific ways of talking to each other, specific norms governing their behaviours. So this is quite a sociological and psychological explanation of groups. Marino and a number of more positivist researchers were interested in understanding the structure of groups in a more abstract way. Marino developed what we would now call social network analysis, which is at the heart of, you know, many modern technologies like Facebook and Google, many social media platforms. It's all based ultimately back on the work of Marino. Marino essentially went into a school in New York, it was a girls' school, I believe, and asked the girls to list who they were friends with and whether they felt a strong tie to those friends or a weak tie, whether they saw the people as a close friend or a distant friend or a strong acquaintance. And what he found was that when you asked people to do this, when you recorded relationships with people, very clear groupings emerged, much like White observed. What looks like just a mess of, you know, a whole school, you realise there's very clear groups. But those groups tend to have particular structures. There are particular roles that people have within groups. Some people have subsequently suggested that these kinds of roles can be assessed through psychometrics. Marino's argument was that they are primarily to be revealed not through psychometrics, but behaviourally, by observing people, observing who the, what he calls, central actors are in networks. A similar approach is adopted by Bales in his interaction pattern analysis. Bales was specifically interested in understanding communication patterns amongst groups. And like White, like Moreno, he suggested that when you look at how people communicate in groups, you start to see that there is a lot more structure to what otherwise might just appear lots of people talking together. So Bales suggested that there's five essential types of communication structure in groups. You can have chains where one person talks to another, who talks to another, who talks to another. So these are very hierarchical. You can have what he called a Y-shaped grouping, which would be similar to a chain, but at some point that chain breaks off where you have a key central actor who mediates information down to multiple other actors. You can have wheels where information is fed to the central actor. You can have circles where everybody speaks essentially to one other person, but it's decentralized. So the person which would otherwise be at the bottom, so if you look at the chain, E is at the bottom, it's the last person to be communicated with. In a circle, E is still the last person to be communicated with, but they would then speak to the first person. So this is a decentralized approach. And finally, you can have an all-channel communication network, an all-channel group where everybody is free to talk equally to each other. These kinds of models have been particularly useful for thinking about organizations because they alert us to the issue of centralization and hierarchy. One of the things which has been discovered is for centralized communication patterns, they can be very effective at what we might call command and control, very effective at making sure that the right person has the right information that they need, and only that information. So this chain is a hierarchy. We might assume that people at the top are making strategic decisions, people at the bottom are making operational decisions, deciding, you know, what words to write on the letter, whereas people at the top are deciding what processes should we follow, should we be writing letters. The problem with these kinds of centralized networks, however, is that they are very susceptible. They're very easily threatened. All you need to do is take out one element of a centralized group and the group starts to fall apart. The same isn't true of, in particular, the all-channel decentralized communications network, where you can take out one element but people are still able to communicate with each other. So for organization studies and for management, one of the key implications of thinking about group structures is that it helps us to understand how centralized groups are, who are the key important actors in groups. The chain would suggest, you know, A is the most important because they start the whole process. But Moreno realized in many groups, actually, there aren't those simple straight lines. You have strong ties, but also weak ties. So what might appear formally as a chain, in reality, thanks to informal organizations, if you think back to our earlier lecture, might be more of a circle or an all-channel group. But the key point is, in network perspectives, we're looking to try to describe the group ideally in terms of its relationships between members. We're looking to see who communicates with each other, who has a strong or weak tie with other people, what kind of hierarchy develops. And a key issue which emerged out of all of this research was the question of leadership and understanding how leaders are elected in groups, but also how once a leader has been elected into a group, they have the ability to shape the way the group interacts. Leaders of groups can decide whether to adopt a more or less hierarchical or centralized style of leadership. Lewin and Lippitt were some early researchers looking at the impact of leadership styles. And again, I don't really know quite why it is, but in their studies, they looked at groups of young children, I think it was 10-year-old boys who were in welfare in Iowa, I think it is. And each group, I think there was four groups that they looked at, and each group had an adult leader. And Lewin and Lippitt recognised that the adult leaders could adopt what they described as one of three different styles which changed the way the group interacted. You had authoritarian leaders who focused very much on the group doing what they were told, not answering back, focused primarily on achievement. You had democratic leaders who focused more on encouraging the groups to make decisions for themselves. They would explain decisions to all members of the group and emphasise that any decision was the group's decision, not their decision. So the authoritarian leader was very much a sort of centralised chain. They were the person at the top telling everybody else what to do. The democratic leaders were perhaps more like a wheel, where they were asking all of their group members to give them information. Taken to its extreme, the democratic leader almost was just an equal part of the group. They let themselves be an equal part of the group. Finally, Lewin and Lippitt said they observed they're what they called laissez-faire leaders, or leaders who don't really have any involvement. They just leave the followers alone and they only really give advice or intervene if the group asks them to. So in a sense, they're kind of anti-leaders. And Lewin and Lippitt's key point was the leader, the group leaders, had a choice as to which style of leadership they adopted, and their choice affected the group's relationships. Bales and Slater, and this is the same Bales that created interaction pattern analysis, built on these ideas, and they suggested that leadership styles can effectively relate to groups in one or two ways. You can have leaders who focus on tasks, on getting jobs done, and they might make suggestions, express opinions, give information. This is what Bales and Slater call task communication functions. This is what task leaders do. So they're much more interested in getting things done. They're more akin to the authoritarian leaders of Lewin and Lippitt. The difference is authoritarian leaders, it's almost a political view, very much see themselves as having power and telling people what to do without them resisting them. Bales and Slater's task leader doesn't necessarily depend on everybody in the group doing what they're told, but it does depend on everybody in the group being focused on completing the tasks at hand. So it can still be done in an involved, democratic way. Bales and Slater's next description of leaders is what they called the socio-emotional leader, who is more interested in encouraging group members to share ideas, more interested in getting the group to bond as a group than getting the task done. Bales and Slater said socio-emotional leaders are more interested in doing what's called maintenance functions. They're more interested in maintaining healthy relationships within the group than getting the task done. Clearly, both approaches have some really beneficial features to them. And Bales and Slater's key point, or one of the key points you can take away from their idea, was that actually a strong leader should be able to switch between both of these perspectives. So when we think about leadership influences on groups, we can see how different styles of leadership, different focuses of leadership, whether they are more authoritarian or democratic, can affect the communication styles and relationships in a group, whether they're more task orientated or more socio-emotional orientated, shapes the kinds of group relationships. So the second perspective on understanding group structure very much focuses on leadership. One of the complications to this was that it was noticed that in many groups, leadership acts are not necessarily carried out just by leaders. What does this mean? Well, it means whilst there might be leadership styles amongst groups, we can't necessarily just look at the formal leaders in the organisational hierarchy to understand what they are. So this led more to a focus than looking at the group as a whole, than just looking at the leaders. What was known as or what is known as organisational dramaturgy, takes this to an extreme. It suggests that if we want to understand a group, we have to think about that group as a role system or a role structure. We have to think about what different roles the actors in the group have to perform. And the classic example of this is what's known as impression management. The observation that many people's roles in organisations is literally to perform for others. Other people in the organisation are their audience, their customers or clients might be their audience, and their job is to perform for them. So, you know, the example would be people working at Disneyland. It's not just the characters that are performing for guests at Disneyland, the people attending to the rides, the maintenance people are all playing roles. And taken to its extreme, organisational dramaturgy encourages us to think about everybody in an organisation as playing the role of a manager, the role of a leader. So it investigates, where do these roles come from? How do people learn the scripts that they enact in organisational dramas? And the key observation here is that in many organisations, they're not explicitly told by the formal organisation how to act and what their role is. Instead, it's the informal organisations, the norms that they pick up through socialisation, through gaining access to the group, which tells them what to do. Organisational dramaturgy then tries to understand the roles and the role system of a group in terms of the group itself, which is very interesting if you want to understand a specific group. But one of the problems with it is, what do you then do with that? How do you apply roles from Disneyland to other organisations? It's here that researchers have adopted I suppose, a more positivist or objectivist sorry, it's been a long day, approach to understanding group roles. Byrne and Sheets provide a key example of this. They suggest that in any group, there's three roles that have to be occupied by people. There are task roles, what they call, on this image, they call personal roles, but in our Huczynski and Buchanan reading, they call maintenance roles, and then individual self-oriented roles, what in this image is called dysfunctional roles. So there are people who have to act in ways to get things done. They have to give opinions. They have to give information. They have to initiate decisions. They have to record what's happened. These are all just functional, practical things that have to get done in groups. Then there are maintenance or emotional sides to groups. People have to encourage, they have to harmonise, they have to follow, they have to lead, they have to diffuse conflicts. Then you've got dysfunctional or self-interested roles, which might be somebody being aggressive, they might block things, they might have a special interest that they want to pursue. Byrne and Sheets said, if you look at any group, you'll find examples of people enacting each of these roles. You might find specific individuals have different task, personal and dysfunctional roles that they're enacting at any one time. But whatever the case, these roles have to be completed in order for groups to work. The task has to be done. The group has to maintain itself in some way, but it also has to accommodate to individuals. Perhaps the most famous example of this approach to thinking about group structure is Belbin. Belbin suggests that there are fundamentally nine different team roles which individuals can occupy. We'll briefly go through a few of them. The key point, which we'll pick up at the end, is that for Belbin, these are roles that you have a natural affinity towards. Everybody is a mixture of all of them, but most people tend to be best at one of these roles, and you can actually do psychometric tests to find out which one you are best at. So you might be a plant, and you might be reactive, let's try to spell this correctly, imaginative, unorthodox. You might love difficult problems. Problem with plants, so the plant here is, it's not a plant like a stooge, but a plant like somebody that grows. You know, you plant seeds and they grow. The problem with plants is that they can be poor in communication. They can get so involved in their imagination in pursuing unorthodox ideas, they might ignore details or struggle to take people with them. You could have a resource investigator. This is somebody who is typically more extroverted. They explore opportunities, develop contacts, You know, this is the salesman, enthusiastic, is that how you spell it? No. Well, whatever, however you spell enthusiastic and opportunities, oh goodness me. The problem with resource investigators is that they can often be very optimistic. They can be really focused. There you go. They can be really focused on getting out there and talking to people, not actually dealing with the real problems. And if things don't work, that optimism shifts and they can lose interest. You can have a... Crikey me, who typed these slides up, guys? You can have a coordinator. The coordinator is somebody who's a good person to have as a chairperson of a group. Somebody who is good at clarifying goals. Somebody who's very mature. Somebody who makes decisions, but also delegates activities and ensures that everybody is keeping on top of their briefs. The downsides of the coordinator is they could sometimes be accused of delegating their own work and therefore not really contributing to the task. Some might see them as manipulative because they can very quickly develop positions of power. They can force groups to become more centralized. You know, if we go to the wheel type image, the coordinator is more of a C type person here in this image. They want to be at the center of everything. We have shapers. And shapers are challenging, they're dynamic, they thrive on pressure. They want to stimulate other people. They want to challenge other people, but of course the problem with that is that they could hurt other people's feelings. They can be seen to be manipulative. Now, I won't go through all of these because I don't want this video to be too long, but if you're interested, you'll notice that the Belbin team roles tests are incredibly popular in industry. It's widely accepted that people tend to have one of these team roles. You'll see, though, how in Belbin's team roles, nobody is explicitly the leader. Each person has a particular task that they have to achieve that they almost have to lead on. The plant is responsible for generating new ideas. The coordinator is responsible for making sure people stay on track. So again, it's more of an egalitarian view. It's a view which doesn't focus on leadership influences, but thinking about the types of roles and systems that develop in groups. Where it differs from organisational dramaturgy is for Belbin, all groups and all individuals have these roles. Organisational dramaturgy tends to just look at specific types of performance and the roles associated with a specific group. So it's not looking at the types, it's looking at the roles. Hopefully that makes sense. Okay, so hopefully we've looked at network perspectives, we've looked at Bayles' interaction pattern analysis, Moreno's social network analysis, we've looked at leadership influences on groups, we've looked at the work of Lewin and Leppitt, and we've looked at Belbin's team roles and organisational dramaturgy as a way of understanding the role system or role structure in a group. If you want to read more of this, into this topic, please look at Huczynski and Buchanan. It's chapter 10 in the 6th edition, chapter 11 in the 9th edition. And as always, ask any questions on the discussion forum or come to the Ask Me Anything drop-in sessions in the lecture engagement slots.